thanks for coming on. And I'm doing this project with together with Anatoly Kmetyuk. I haven't met him in real life yet. He's from Odessa, a 20-year-old student, LOL, but his faculty didn't give him permission to come here, otherwise I would have met him also. And so the overview of my talk is, I will first argue that programming is still hard for some purposes. I'll give some history on algebraic approaches to modeling processes, and in particular on the, I'll say something about the so-called algebra of communicating processes. Then I'll talk about my implementation of this theory on top of the language Scala, and give some examples. Maybe I'll demo the debugger. And then some new developments. I hope to show a Twitter client and some actors modeled this system. And then come to the conclusion. So why is programming still hard? It's because programming languages are mainly good in batch processing, but not so good in parsing and concurrency and event handling, such things. And there are solutions for these things, but they often result in callback hell. And there have been good approaches in the past, but these idioms have been neglected. For instance, non-imperative choice, as you have in grammar specification languages such as BNF and YAG, yet another compiler. Another thing that you don't see very well in programming languages is things like Unix pipes, although they are getting there now in frameworks on top of Scala, for instance. How can we solve this? Well, I think math can come to the rescue. And it's particularly algebra. That's, in my view, a relatively easy form of math. Numeric algebra, we have numbers like 0 and 1, and we have variables like x and y, and we can do addition and multiplication and so on. And there are certain rules about commutativity and so on. For logic, there are something similar, truth and false values, and 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 OR operations, but they are mathematically equivalent to addition and multiplication. And there are again some rules. In principle, you can extend these Boolean algebra rules to processes just by adding new kind of elements, which we call atomic actions. So we now have elements like 0 and 1, not exactly false and true, but say deadlock, a process cannot do anything, or 1, the process is already finished successfully. And then you have these atomic actions, A and B and so on, and you can also have variables or refinements, X and Y. And then we have addition and multiplication. Now, multiplication becomes non-commutative. Multiplication means first the left part and then the right part in sequence operation. And in terms of addition and multiplication, you can define parallelism and also other things. Again, there are these rules. Let me go back to a little bit of history. And I'll refer also to my this website for this project. On the there's here a menu item which has subscripts history, and you can look up many things there, and there are also links to all the documents. For instance, I would like to go to put on my glasses. So in the 1930s, and Turing came up with this model of a computing machine, and that inspired two people, Pitts and McCulloch, to write a paper in 1943 about how the brain works. And that was a very influential paper. It inspired, for instance, John von Neumann in his work, but also Stephen Kleine. Kleine had worked with Turing and Church in the 30s on lambda calculus, and now he went in a different direction. So he started from this paper by Pitts and McCulloch, but he was more interested in a mathematical model of things that happen in the brain, events. And this way he led the foundation for formal languages and regular expressions and finite automata. I just want to recommend you this nice paper of him. It's 1955 published, without computer typesetting, but it looks great. And if you browse a little bit through it. So it's very well typeset. And on page 36, there is, he gets to these algebraic rules of the type that you've seen before. And these algebraic rules are about events. And it's like here. And you see these nice sigma things, which are summations, very nice mathematics. And this is almost process algebra. The only thing is it's just sequential, so there's no concurrency yet. But that's 1955, more than half a century ago. So at the same time, around the same time, Noam Chomsky, who is still politically active, he presented a paper on the language grammars. And thereafter, there were many other developments, for instance, with the compilers and so on. Around 1980, there were a few important developments. Hoare and Milner came up with concurrency theories. And thereafter in Amsterdam, Jan Bergsta and Jan Willem Klop. They were also inspired by the stuff from Hoare and Milner. But they had a real nice, clean, algebraic approach to this. And a few, about a decade later, Milner combined this these concurrency theories, his CCS, with lambda calculus, and he got related to result of pi calculus. And also 1989, about the same time, Henk Groeman in Leiden, also did something like that. And there's a very nice paper as well. This is the paper by Groeman. It's a very short paper, so it has positive sides and also negative sides, because it was a bit too short. He didn't explain well enough what he was really doing, and therefore nobody knows this paper, almost, and that's a pity, because it's quite elegant what he really does. He has some rules about things that can happen. I won't go into the details, but you see here some kind of, if you're familiar with lambda calculus, you see here some specifications, typically lambda calculus. And he could do quite nice things. Unfortunately, though, the paper was a bit too short, because here we are already at the end. Okay. So what about this theory? So as I said, the algebra of communicating processes is a bit like Boolean algebra, but we also have then next to truth values, you have atomic actions. And we can express parallelism and process communication, and things like disruption and interruption, and even time and space and probabilities and money. It has been used to specify communication protocols and to verify these production plans. The Dutch railways had a project with this about 20 years ago. Coffee and coffee machines and money and economy. Strengths are familiar syntax. It's just math. It's expressions. Precise semantics, and you can do reasoning using term rewriting. And also nice is that events input things input is treated in the same way as actions or output internal computations or something like that. And it's a more natural way of writing things down than what's usually done in programming languages. So we have here five basic axioms of process algebra. And just to show you how this theory works, we have also these special elements like 0 and 1. And how does the theory work? Now suppose you have this expression, x plus 1 and then y. So how could you find out what it really means? We can apply this axiom as a rewrite rule from left to right. Then we get x times y plus 1 times y. And we can rewrite the 1 times y again with the rewrite rule. And then we get this expression. And now we see x can happen and then y, or y can happen. In other words, x is optional. Just this x becomes optional just by having an immediate success as an alternative. We can also specify parallelism or concurrency. Say, when two processes are running in parallel, then the left one can start first and the rest goes in parallel with the right hand side, or the other way around, or that it can start by communicating and then the rest goes in parallel. So there are other axioms for this. I haven't given the full axioms, but the interesting thing here is that all processes come down to either a choice or a sequence that starts with an atomic action, or a 1 or a 0. That's all you have. And this way you can define axioms for all other operations as well. Now, notes the main, one of the main challenges is to get this working. And basically this has been done already in 1980 by Jan van den Bos. And he made something like called the input tool model. It was meant to describe user input, graphical user interfaces. It was based on, inspired by path expressions, maybe you know that. I came to work in the group of Jan van den Bos in Leiden in 1985. And I started working with this system and it changed a little bit. And then rebranded it and to Scriptic and just put on the languages Pascal, Modular, C++, and Java. And something similar was made by Jan Bergs and Paul Klint in Amsterdam, which is what's called Toolbus. It was more a glue of programs rather than a normal general purpose programming language. And a few years ago, I decided to move to Scala and to rethink everything that I had, and also rebrand thing to Subscript. And application areas, GUI controllers, text parsers, event simulation, and right now it becomes a reactive programming with actors and data flow. So where does it stand with the programming paradigms? So imperative program languages are assembly and C, and you can add lambdas. anonymous functions to these. You get things like Lisp and Haskell. You can also go in another direction, add object orientation. You have then C++ or Java 1.2.7. Or you can combine these two. You have things like Smalltalk or Scala or Java 8. But you can also go in a different direction, more declarative. So you have Prolog and things like Yux. And I would also say Unix command shell language, because it has this pipe operator. And again, you can make more combinations. So if you add declarative spout to Java, then you get Java compiler. But if you go the whole way, then you arrive at the subscript, but also another project that you may know is Parboiled. It's a parser combinator library on top of Scala. So let's go to a simple application. I suppose we want to make a GUI controller for such a program. We have a search field and a button. Maybe as soon as we press the button, then this program should start the search. Must write a message here, and later it should come back with the results. And meanwhile, this button must be disabled until the results return. So how do we write this in normal, in Java or in Scala with Swing? Well, you have the search code. I won't go into details, but it's code that I really dislike myself, mainly because there's so much indentation and these parentheses. I think parentheses are indication of too hard programming concepts. And if you go to look at the control flow, you start on top, there the button is created. Then at some other point in time, when the button is clicked, you get here. And what are you doing then? You go all the way down to start. What does start do? It starts a thread over there. And then it will switch to another thread to get things working. So it's a bit, also the control flow is a bit like spaghetti. How would I write this in this algebraic approach? You make so-called scripts. So main script is called here lib. We start with the click action on the search button. Then in the GUI thread, we set the text. In the background thread, we do the search, which is now modeled as a C. And after a while, we set some text in the GUI thread. And we do it over and over again, so this is kind of a true operation. So we have here a sequence, just like the Scala, new line is a kind of sequence operator. And this GUI thing, it's in an annotation. The GUI thing itself is not part of the language, it's in the library. You can write it down in a few lines. And it's implemented using these string utilities, invocator and invoke-await functions, if you know them. And these asterisks here, they denote that we are executing this piece of code in a separate thread. And that when this thread has ended, then we continue with the rest. Now you can have such a program with lots of these clicked commands. And in Scala, you usually then use something like called implicit conversions. So in the Scala style, we can get rid of this clicked thing and just write down search button. And it makes the program even shorter. So this is a feature of Scala. We can also write it down in a different way, using more refinements, more scripts. So we say lib is a search sequence, and that's iterated. And search sequence is search command, searching text, and so on. And we can have such a specification, which I like in general more. and previous thing. Now, that was a very simple application. We can make it a bit more interesting. Like say that we also want to have a keyboard input. The enter key should start a search. It should be able to cancel a search with the cancel button or with the escape key. And we should be able to exit with the button or pressing the closing box. So how would you do that? Oh yeah, and also the search field should only be the search button should only be enabled when the field here is not empty. And we also want to have some progress indication when the search is running. So I'll try some. I'll first show how this works, and then I'll do some live coding. And I have no risk that it doesn't work, of course. So, if you want to try this out, it's not too hard. You can go to the website and go to the applications, the examples, and then clone this Git repository in your desktop just by clicking and say, and providing a directory where you want to have it. Then you go to the directory and you give a command, gradle run or so. And this will get all the libraries that you need from using this Maven tool. And it will install a subscript and it will compile and then run. So here you have the application. We can type a search string. You see that the go button is now enabled. I can go. I can do an exit. Meanwhile, the search continues. I say no. I can go another time and can cancel here. And I can also exit here, or maybe, yeah. So this actually works. Now I want to show you how you can get this to work. So I prepared here the text. So this is a typical Scala style of setting up the GUI controls. So we have here this live script. Now for the search command, I need to add this option of an additional key. So just like this. So that's it. So what we are basically doing here is we, on a mathematical, in a mathematical sense, we are adding a button to a character code or keyboard code. And that makes sense. We are not adding processes, we can add any kind of data, as long as there are appropriate implicit conversions defined. And you control those implicit conversions because it's Scala. And from a theoretical point of view, we are now past an algebra of processes. We have an algebra of anything. And you can give it any meaning. The cancel command is similar, so we have key escape. And for the exit button, we have another event, we have the window closing. So it's just easy as that. For the search command, we want to guard this this field, this search button. The text field should not be empty, so we can invoke a so-called script that I have named guard. And the first parameter is the search text field. And the second parameter is a predicate which says whether the field is empty. So this is the Scala notation of giving such a predicate. It's a function with zero parameters, and it will return a predicate. The text field is not empty. Yes, that's it. Another thing is cancellation. So we have the guard. It guards whether you can start the search. When you're already doing the search, you should be able to cancel. And that has a special operator, which is slash, means disruption. So we have here cancel search. And cancel search has been defined here. It starts with the cancel command, and then it sets a message in the GUI.
There's a typo.
Sorry?
There's a typo.
A typo?
Sorry? That's probably the mouse.
No,
okay.
Oh,
yeah. Sorry. Let's now go to the exiting functionality.
Sorry, I have a question. Does the disruption operator have the highest priority here? So
yeah.
Cancel everything from the guard?
Yeah, that's a good question. Now, just like in Scala, the semicolon and new lines have a very low priority. But you see here a new line. But it doesn't really count as a kind of semicolon, because next line starts with slash. That's a bit different with Scala, because Scala doesn't want to accept here a slash. I think mainly because it could have also been a minus, and a minus is also a unary operator in Scala. Let's go to the exiting functionality. So for this, we have an exit command. And we want to give this IO sure dialog. So the way I programmed this a few years ago, it was like this. I had a variable which says it's a boolean, and I had to set to false here. And then I run the confirmation dialog. And I had to do that in the GUI thread, so that the rest can nicely proceed. Yeah, could write it like this. And finally, if the confirmation was true, then you had to exit. So, but the effect is exiting is a kind of loop. You have to repeat it all over again until you have confirmed. So you write it down as Y while not B. So it's a loop, but meanwhile other things will have to run. So here on top, at the highest level, I place this exit process in parallel with the rest. And this form of parallelism is OR parallelism. The two bars is also in Scala and Java and C known as Boolean OR, and also with these processes. So the meaning here is that when either operand of this operator is successfully ended, then the whole ends. On the left hand, we have an internal loop, so that never ends successfully, but on the right hand, we have this do exit, and as soon as you have given the command and you have confirmed that you want to exit, then do exit is ready and the whole program will stop. So this is parallelism and logic in one. But 2 years ago, I gave a presentation at EPFL in Lausanne, where Scala is being developed. And Yevgeny Bermako, the guy behind Scala Macros, afterwards he came to me and said, get rid of the vars. So I had two vars in my presentation, and one of these was this one. And it's a bit a low-level thing. So I thought he was completely right. And I started thinking how to get rid of it. And that same day I got some first ideas, and finally, after about 2 years, I got some a solution implemented. This is I should have written it a bit differently here. So this works. So we have the confirmation dialog, but we don't need a variable anymore. And we can just hand the result to the while. And for this, I have got a kind of pipeline operator. I can annotate what it is. So and that's it. So this works as well. And basically, it's a kind of sequential composition what you see here with some syntactic sugar. So this confirm dialog is becomes a kind of action, and the result is captured and then given as a parameter to the right hand side here. So this, in fact, is under the hood we have here a lambda, anonymous function. Another way to write this down would be like this, just an arrow, and then have here a real anonymous function in the Scala style. And it becomes even shorter this way. Okay, so far for this coding demo.
I think there's a typo actually.
Yeah, I'm not going to compile this.
Oh, okay.
You didn't close the parentheses.
There's a curly bracket missing after the GUI there.
Oh, yes. Great. Now you really see it easily because the alignment with the previous line. Eh?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, there's one thing I forgot. We also want to have a progress monitor. No, it's simple. Another parallel process to the search action. And it's or parallel, so as soon as the search is ended, this progress monitor will also stop. And I prepared the progress monitor here. It's just another loop. You put a message in the text field, in the output field, and then you sleep a while, and that loops.
Excuse me, shouldn't that be a single pipe for parallel operation?
This one?
Yeah.
No, because as soon as the search action, which is modeled here on the left-hand side, is over, then you want to stop it.
Sure.
Yeah. The stupid thing is that the theorists in Amsterdam, they only have normal parallelism, which I write down here with ampersand. But in practice, I only use this OR parallelism.
Okay.
Because it's almost always good enough.
Do you wait for the two processes to complete?
Then you give this single ampersand. So then the show both should complete, but the focus monitor will never complete. We could also have a double ampersand. It says as soon as one of these processes ends in failure, then the whole also will end. And of course there's also a single bar, but I don't ever use that. Oh, 10 minutes. Okay, let's move fast to a different application. So there's more to say about the implementation. Basically, the implementation is quite simple. So we have an abstract syntax tree of a specification, and at runtime, you create a call graph, which matches closely the syntax tree, but some different parts may be active at a certain point of time. And there's a compiler which transforms such specifications into methods. And the transformations are not that complicated. And the virtual machine that interprets all these things here consists about 2,000 or 3,000 lines right now. And there are also some event handling scripts, and we have also a graphical debugger that produces these kinds of things that grow as well. Let me go to the next slide. Okay, I have to. That's also this sheet, sorry. So this is well, how what the debugger looks like. You can easily start with Gradle debug. So in 5 minutes you can have this working and see how these processes behave. I had also a controller for the debugger also built in subscript in a separate VM. And this is what I want to say about this data flow. So basically we need arrows and these lambdas. So it's good to mention that because this is lambda days. So that those are different forms. We also need results for these scripts, like methods can have results. And that adds something to the theory. I don't know what it is yet. But I think you can reason about this as well. And this enables the data flow. And maybe you know this parboiled partial combinator library. It does similar things. And I'm very inspired by parboiled because it has very nice options to do something with these results. Oh yeah, and for data flow, an addition to the normal data flow is exception flow. So if a process ends in failure, like also a future can, then we can have an alternative broken arrow. And you get the right-hand side gets an exception to handle. And you can even have a ternary operator. So normal data flow here, and then the bad data flow on the right. And then you can have these parameters that normally would appear here on the right. You can have them inside the arrows. That's a relatively recent work, so it's not entirely stable right now, the definition. Let me show you very quickly a Twitter search example that we created here with this. So you can search for lambda days, and when you type, you don't want to send a command to Twitter for each character that you type, because Twitter will then say goodbye, you're asking too much. So you want to wait a little bit, let's say 100 or 200 milliseconds, and then you only then you send the command to Twitter, please give me the tweets. And after the Twitter has returned, you get these. Now this example has been inspired on the reactive programming course from Coursera. May I ask who did of you did this course 2 years ago or so? So about 4. Personally, I found this course quite hard. And there was a wiki suggestions assignment, and that inspired me to build this one. But I found it very hard, and the way you would program in that style, this Twitter example is like this. You have something like reactions, and you add things here on the right, do a flat map, and later an oncomplete. Flat map for a search, for a wait future, and then you have a search future. So I didn't really like this style. So therefore, I have this an alternative with the data flow. So you have a main sequence of searches, and the sequence each search, every time you type a character, and if there is a search ongoing or a wait ongoing, then you can disrupt it and start over again. So what do you do? You wait for any event in the search text field, then you wait for a delay, and then you search in the background and the result. If it's okay, then you update the tweets view. If it's not okay, you get an exception, IO exception for instance. Accept the error message. And you can even now use these features from the from this this version. You have here two interpretable features. You can even use these instead of this wait for delay and search in background, like this. So here the features again, you use them here. That's possible using Scala's implicit conversion mechanism. So I defined a future to script conversion. It says execute the future, non-complete, well, this event happens. Basically, that's what it says. Probably, we can also implicitly convert scripts back into futures. So this way, I think we can combine futures with each other in a nicer way using this this algebraic approach. But then, we haven't experimented with this yet, and I think that would be nice to find out. So there's also similar things for subscript actors. I won't have much time for this yet, but in principle you can also handle messages this way in actors. And it gives you more an approach like you're parsing a grammar and you don't have this receive method and so on. And you can also do here again implicit conversions, and you can even write these kinds of specifications. There's more to say. Also, we made examples inspired by the reactive programming course. And this is typically what you see in ACCA actors in Scala code, with the become and so on. I didn't like it. The first alternative that I would have, I didn't like it either, but we can handle messages. And inside this handling, you can handle other messages and so on. And here it happens on three levels. But again, you get lots of these indentation and so on. And it's also always a sign, in my view, that things become too hard. So a better approach would be like this. So what we could do is accept the message, then we send it on. And this is the echo notation to create the future. We send it. So to send a request to another actor and then to wait for the result. This is the future. And then the result of the future, you can do it again, you can do another action like that. And with that, those results from there, we can send back to the sender. So this does basically do the same as this here. I think that's a nice improvement. Maybe we need a little bit different syntax here, but in principle we can reach some things like here, like this. Okay, implementation is not too hard, thanks also to the openness of ACCA. It really lets you hack into the system in a very neat way. That's it. Now, we reached the conclusion. So we can do easy and efficient programming. The execution is a bit less efficient. You reach about 10,000 to 100,000 actions per second, which is good enough for GUI controllers, but not good. It's slower than ACCA, for instance, because that easily processes about a million messages per second. And with this system, you will be at least, I think, 100 times slower. But often it may be good enough. Implementation, I think, is now about 6,000 lines, and we're at 50%. We use now a branch of the Scala compiler, but we want to move to this parboiled system. Maybe you've heard of Scala tags. That works also with parboils, and we will use macros to get a leader implementation. And I would be very interested in the Node.js version, and that would be possible because Scala now also targets JavaScript rather than just the Java virtual machine. So open source project, there are two websites, subscripttime.org and GitHub. There's still much to do and many patterns and so on and theory to discover. I like this project myself very much, and Anthony as well. I hope you also will be interested and have a look at the project. Try out the examples and this debugger, for instance, and maybe also join the project. And that concludes my talk. Any questions? Yes, you're first. You mentioned, okay, because we are at the lambda days, I needed lambda and arrows. So the arrows, are they really the arrows? What are the arrows you're referring to?
The arrows in the in examples, so you have a process, arrow, another process, which means data flows from left to right.
Okay, okay,
yeah.
Correct. It's nothing to do with arrow calculus.
No, no, I don't
okay,
know that.
Okay,
no. Yes?
I just want to ask you if I understood you correctly. So the main goal was to create some kind of algebra which is able to describe the parallel processing, some simple rules or some math rules when other defined, and then create some language and some common, let's say, common base for every approaches of reacting, of implementation of reacting manifesto, and that is what you wanted to achieve.
Yeah, but I'm always, I want to achieve, I want to cover all kinds of reactive programming, but each time when I encounter something new, I'm not really sure whether I'll manage. But up to now it works.
But it seems that every of this approach, which is different, let's say in case of Kafka or in case of RX Java, yes, so in this case it is a little bit different, but in fact they have some one common understanding. I mean, behind that there is
Some truth out there, but you see what I'm doing here is related to what Parboat does, but also to what the futures do. The futures have also a notion of success and failure. But what do these futures exactly do? I don't really understand. It has not been described in a clean theory. That's what's missing, I think. And also, if you look in these parser generators languages, like Yug and so on, it is almost process algebra, but you never find the axioms there. Also, what the computer science students are told at almost all universities in the world, it's formal languages and automata. It's almost algebra, it's almost very neat scientific algebra, but it's not completely it. And that's a very big pity, I think. At Eindhoven University in Holland, the students there get taught process algebra as a basis for formal languages and automata. I think that's a much better approach. Yeah.
This will have to be the last question.
Yes.
We're over time.
So I have a question. Does this process algebra give any guarantees with respect to deadlocking, like it will compile type check if there's a deadlock, or it's
using the question is about deadlock detection. Can you do it on using this process algebra? So this has been a major focus of research in the process algebra. So they could detect deadlocks sometimes, but the theorists also failed sometimes to detect. So 20 years ago there was a student who did with me a project to model a kind of factory with moving kind of trains and so on, and it has also been analyzed by the theorists, and they made a model and they had a kind of simulator and so on, and we built the same system, and the student then started to load the system with strange test data, and he found a deadlock that nobody had expected. So So you can do deadlock detection sometimes with a theory, but it's hard work and you'll miss some things. And therefore, fast simulations are could be very, very useful. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks.